what happens when you keep a peeled banana out in the open? The banana gradually deteriorates and we find several tiny creatures hovering over it. These tiny creatures are commonly called fruit flies. They're annoying, right? But did you know that these small wonders are one of the most powerful tools for geneticists? Sounds hard to believe, but these fruit flies are used as model organisms in genetics. Let me tell you an extremely important and unbelievable fact. Did you know that the common fruit fly, Drosophila melanogaster, and humans have genes that are almost 60% similar to each other? You heard me right. Just a total of 8 chromosomes in this tiny creature contains around 60% genes similar to the humans. And not only this, but the fruit fly is also used as a model to study the most serious neurodegenerative disorders, including Parkinson's and Alzheimer's. So this little creature is nothing short of a miracle for us. But who thought of using these tiny model organisms for experiments? The use of Drosophila melanogaster as model organisms dates back to several years. However, the organism rose to fame with the experiments to the father of experimental genetics, Thomas Hunt Morgan. Following Boveri and Sutton's chromosomal theory of inheritance, Morgan and his colleagues carried out many experiments on the common fruit fly, which served as further confirmation for the theory. Let's have a look at what experiments he actually performed and what results he got. For that, let's travel back in time and reach the early years of the 20th century. It was around the early years of 1900s that Thomas Hunt Morgan started working on fruit flies with a determination to find something new. Did he really find something interesting? Yes, he did. One fine day, in a vial containing red-eyed flies, Morgan found something strange. He could spot a male fly with white-colored eyes. Morgan knew that this is a special type of mutant and the experiments with this will lead to a new path in genetics. So how did he plan his experiments? What was the procedure? Let's find that out in the next part. Imagine you're working in a lab with a little fruit fly. One fine day, you find an unusual mutant among the other wild types. The wild type means the ones normally found in nature, or the natural forms to be precise. So the mutant form means the ones that have undergone some random or unusual changes. For example, red eye color is the natural or wild type of variety in fruit flies. But the white eye color is a mutant form. So what would you do if you find a mutant type of fruit fly in a vial one day? I'm sure anyone would simply grab the opportunity and begin experimenting with this unique variety. The father of experimental genetics, Thomas Hunt Morgan, was not an exception to this. One fine day, he found a unique mutant in one of his vials while working in the lab. The mutant was a white-eyed male fruit fly. Soon he realized that the exclusive mutant was an ideal model for carrying several experiments that would lead us to new paths in genetics. Let's begin understanding how Morgan carried out his famous experiments on the fruit fly, which later proved the chromosomal theory of inheritance better. Morgan crossed the white-eyed male with a wild type, that is, a red-eyed female. The F1 generation had all the offsprings with red-colored eyes. This showed that red eye color is a dominant trait. Okay, so what's next then? Morgan stepped ahead to cross the F1 hybrids. What he expected was a 3-to-1 ratio. That is what we get in the F2 generation, right? And what should the genotypic ratio be? It should be 1:2:1. And is this what Morgan obtained? Yes, Morgan obtained 3 red-eyed flies and 1 white-eyed fly in the F2 generation. Also, the genotypic ratio was 1 to 2 to 1. These results suggest that Mendel's experiments were correct. Kind of. Mendel had obtained ratios for plants. Here, we considered animals for the experiment. That is why, although Morgan had obtained the ratios just like Mendel did, things didn't end here. Morgan obtained only one white-eyed fly in the F2 generation. But note that this fly is a male. This unfolds a lot of hidden ambiguities. Why didn't he obtain a white-eyed female? Did this hint at something? That's a right guess. The results not only gave a proof of the chromosomal theory of inheritance, but also helped in shining light on newer concepts. Morgan assumed that the eye color genes that are passed down the generation are sex-linked. Now, what could this be? Let's get introduced to this term first. We know that chromosomes in organisms are of two parts. One type is called autosomes, which are simply not the sex chromosomes. And the second category is the sex chromosomes themselves, which determine the sex of the organism. These chromosomes are usually represented with the letters X and Y. In most organisms, individuals with X chromosomes are females, while individuals with one X and one Y are males. Getting back to our concept, sex-linked implies the characters or traits linked to the sex chromosomes. So the characters which usually pass down the generations with respect to a particular sex will be sex-linked. So in this case, Morgan did not stop at the fact that his results confirmed the chromosomal theory. He went a step ahead and put forth the assumption that the genes for eye color are present on the X chromosome in the fruit fly. In the next part, let's understand what Morgan had to say about this. We are in the midst of studying Thomas Morgan's experiment. We have seen so far that Morgan crossed a white-eyed male with a red-eyed female, which is the wild type. The F1 generation had all the offsprings with red-colored eyes. Also, when he obtained the F2 generation, it made him assume that the genes for eye color are present on the X chromosome in the fruit flies. Now, to understand this better, let's carry out a theoretical cross. To begin with, let's denote the chromosomes as X and Y for representation purposes. But if we use X and Y to represent the chromosomes, then how do we represent the genes on these chromosomes? For that, we will write additional letters in superscript. So let's say we write the letter W in lowercase to represent the genes for white-colored eyes. The red-eyed phenotype will then be represented by the letter W in lowercase, having a plus sign after it. Do you think this representation is strange? Well, that's how it's usually done in genetics. The first letter of the mutant type is used for denoting the alleles. Hence, we use the letter W for representing the mutant allele for white eyes. We simply add the plus sign to it to denote the wild type. So instead of using the letter R for red eye color, we use W plus. Also, we need to know that the wild type, which is the red eye trait, is dominant over the mutant type, which is the white eye trait. Getting back to the experiment, Morgan assumed that the genes for the trait are present on the X chromosome. Let's also assume the same and begin crossing and see if we get the same results. So we have the X with W in lowercase for representing the genes that give white-colored eyes. And we have X with W plus for representing the wild type, that is the red-colored eyes. Now we begin the crossing of the white-eyed male with the red-eyed female. The cross yields all the offsprings with red eyes in the F1 generation. This is how the genes are passed to the progeny. Now the next step is crossing the offsprings from this F1 generation. On crossing these two with red eyes, we get a progeny that is in the ratio 3 to 1. So we've got three that are red-eyed and one that's white-eyed. To be precise, we obtain one male with red eyes and two females which are red-eyed. The only white-eyed fly is this male here. If you remember, Morgan obtained the same result. So this assumption that we made gave us the same results as the Morgan's cross. Hence the assumption that the genes for eye color were present on the X chromosome in fruit flies is correct. Now what if the alleles would have been present on the Y chromosome? Then the trait would have been visible only in males. That's because in organisms like Drosophila, males have one X chromosome and one Y chromosome, and females have both X chromosomes. To summarize, this experiment helped Morgan to prove that genes are present on chromosomes. Also, he could find out that the genes for eye color were present on the X chromosome in the fruit fly. This also indicated the fact that genes are passed from one generation to the other. This is how Mendelian genetics, as well as Sutton and Boveri's chromosomal theory of inheritance, were both proved better with Morgan's experiments.